Hey there, and welcome back to My Green Pets. This week, we'll be trekking through the Appalachian Mountains in search of slipper orchids. We'll have a look at a gorgeous book about the orchids of Malaysia, and we'll check back to see what flowers are in bloom in the sunroom, including that beautiful spider orchid, the Brassia. All that and more coming up right now on My Green Pets. If you want to grow orchids successfully, you need to know how they grow in the wild and what their conditions are. For that reason, I've traveled to the city of Pineville in eastern Kentucky to check out the natural habitat of some of our native slipper orchid species. I stayed at the lodge at Pine Mountain State Park. Located on top of Pine Mountain, the lodge offers stunning views, a cozy atmosphere, and super friendly staff. Now I have to admit, I've only recently discovered this part of the country, but I have to say, if you like nature, if you like beautiful nature and beautiful natural surroundings, you will love eastern Kentucky because the mountains have a flora all of their own. You see lots of roots wrapped around rocks and moss everywhere, and it's just the greenest place you can possibly imagine. Some of the big chunks of stone that you see are host to all types of different plants. And I think that there are rhododendrons that are perched upon this particular piece of rock. And I think that it's granite, but I'm not quite sure. But I think it's amazing how the plants are able to take hold of the rock. Kind of defies our expectations that plants grow in soil. Okay, you say, but where are the orchids? Well, to be perfectly honest, the naturalist at the lodge told me where to find them, and boom, there they were. And after I found a couple of patches of them, I realized what type of environment to look for, and suddenly I was finding them everywhere. Here's one. Now, I was quite early in the season, so unfortunately I didn't see any in bloom. So if you were hoping for some flowering orchids like I was, unfortunately I don't have any of that to show you, but what was really interesting was to be able to see where the plants grow and how they grow. That was really what we're here to do. The genus of slipper orchids that we're looking at here are the Cypripediums or Cypripediums, and they tend to grow in colonies, so if you find one, your chances of finding more are pretty high. This one looks like it has the remains of last year's flower spikes still attached. So since we're on a mission to see how these Cypripediums grow in the wild, I poked around in the dirt with a stick. And what I'm doing here is trying to figure out what is the media like? What are they growing in? And if you'll notice, it's very sandy, it's very easily broken up, it's very moist, and it's very soft. I'd like to thank everyone at Pine Mountain State Park for their hospitality and their help. I will definitely be back, and hopefully the slipper orchids will be in bloom next time. Now let's go home and check on my little Cypripedium, which, by the way, is a hybrid that was purchased at a nursery. I would never take a plant out of the wild. I hope that you would not either. It's illegal, and the plants will die after you transplant them, so don't do it. My little slipper orchid is, the hybrid name is Anna. It's a Cypripedium Anna. And it has popped up just a little bit. It's not quite as far along as the ones we saw on the mountain, but it's not too far behind either. And so it's growing. I don't know what's going to happen, but I'm just happy that it's alive and it is growing. Now that I know what kind of soil it needs, I'm going to make sure that the soil around it is loose, sandy, and very similar to what we saw on the mountain. If you'd like to try growing orchids outdoors but don't want the stress of having to deal with Cypripediums, which are expensive and, in my experience, somewhat difficult to grow, you might want to try the hardy Chinese ground orchid or Bletilla striata. These plants that I have in my garden are 25 years old. They were planted as little tubers many, many years ago, and they come back every year, and if they're well cared for, they will multiply. Those will be blooming in the next few weeks. Well, it may be cold and cloudy outside, but it's still a nice day in the sunroom. A lot of different flowers in bloom. So let's have a look around. The flowers are kind of tiered, like I have a layer in the front and then a middle layer and then kind of a back layer to give a nice sense of depth when you walk in the room. So the first layer, obviously, are these big hippeastrums, or amaryllis as we commonly call them, and phalaenopsis, which I actually really like these white ones with the big petals. I just think they're fantastic. The next layer, I guess you could say, is this phalaenopsis party that you see happening in front of you. I kind of lined up all the different flowers on one area so that they kind of create a wall of flowers. And this is the plant with the most flowers. It had 25 blooms. Actually, two of the earliest ones have already dropped off of it. But I think that you could call this an example of bad breeding, because while the plant puts out lots and lots of blooms, they kind of come out as a big mess. And so I would prefer that the plant had fewer flowers in a nicer order than just a profusion of flowers all in a big mess like that. Now as we move to the back layer of this multi-sensory experience, we see Brassia New Start, my favorite plant at the moment, just because of those long, spindly, spiky flowers. They're just really great. I love them. Brassias are actually really hard to photograph because in order to show the whole flower, because it's so large, you have to zoom out quite a bit. But when you do that, you end up losing detail. So when you get close to the flower to show the detail, you lose the shape of the flower and you can't see how big the thing is. So it's really quite a challenge to photograph it in a nice way that will convey the intricacies of the patterning and the colors, but at the same time show the shape and the long spindly petals. This little slipper orchid's a lot easier to photograph. Its flower fits neatly in the frame. Well, now that we've had a look around, I wanted to show you a book that I've received this week in the mail from the other side of the world. The Forest Research Institute of Malaysia published this book in 2011. The title is Wild Orchids of Peninsular Malaysia. And it's got photographs of all the different orchids that you can find growing in the wild in Malaysia. And I am a big fan of the Bulbophyllum genus, and there are so many in this book. It's just beautiful. Many orchids I've never seen before. But some that I have, including one of my favorites, the Bulbophyllum medusae. Well, that just about wraps it up for this week's episode of My Green Pets. I hope that you've enjoyed your visit and look forward to seeing you next time. Take care, guys. Thank you.